morning, sir. My name is Apurva, and I'm representing Symbiosis Institute of Computer Studies and Research. And a very warm good morning to all the esteemed colleagues out here. SICSR, as is the short form of our institute, is a part of Symbiosis International University, which is located in Pune. The Symbiosis International University has many constituent institutes which are in the diversified fields like humanities, law. We have also institutes that offer courses in design, in HRM and finance, etc., etc. But today I'm talking from the as a representative of the Faculty of Computer Studies, under which we've got three institutes, and I belong to the SICSR Institute of it. One thing I would like to tell you here before going ahead is that since our institute is not an engineering institute like most of us here have, so we as an institute are not offering engineering courses, but we have an engineering college who's offering courses in engineering. But since I'm not representing that, I would rather speak from the perspective of my institute. So our institute going ahead offers following kind of courses, which are some of the PG and UG courses. Here under the PG courses head, we have got two courses. One is the MBA degree, which is a master's degree. It's not an PG diploma. This MBA degree is in the information technology field. So it is, it contains all those programming languages and computer related stuff, which is technical. But in addition to that, it also has an equal focus on the managerial aspect of IT, that is in terms of project management, project structures, life cycles of development, service oriented architectures, and so on. And our next course, which is the MSc in computer applications, we can say that it's a purely technical course, wherein we can say it's not excluded, but not much of focus is given on architectures or managerial aspect of IT. So it's a pure technical course. And the graduate degree programs, we are having BCA and BBIT. Again, the distinction is the same. The BCA course is a more technical one as compared to the Bachelor's of Business Administration from the IT perspective. In addition to these two PG courses that have been listed here, we also have a executive MBA kind of a course, which was specially designed for a company called as Mindtree in Bengaluru. For the employees in that company, we have started a new initiative called as an MBIT course, which we would go to their campus and offer there. It's a 3-year course, because they are going to do the course as a weekend course and evening classes. So it is stretched on to 3 years instead of 2. And we offer the same degree, that is a PG degree from the SIU University. So that's something that I've not listed here. Going ahead, since we all are speaking from the perspective of C or C++, what I would like to tell you is we also cover all of it, but the perspective that we go about our approach is a little different, because we have students who come post 12th standard for our UG courses. We offer some kind of introductory papers, which may be more or less parallel to the computer programming or fundamentals of programming, like most of you have projected it to be. And going ahead, then we have a paper for C, and then we have a paper for C++. After those two papers, in the later semesters, we start touching upon object orientation and then move on to Java. And then for courses like MSc and all that, we go ahead and cover J2ME, J2EE, and advanced technologies in some of the platforms. So here I'm showing you a syllabus of a paper called as Logic Development, which is offered for both the UG courses, that is BBA and BCA. So in this, we start with really basic knowledge, assuming that the students that are coming in have no exposure to IT apart from using the computer a few times. So here we start by touching upon algorithms, flowcharts, and some approaches or methods of problem solving. Then we go ahead with telling them about what is a pseudocode and how you can use it when you're doing a programming thing. After that, we go on to introducing them to programming. Then here we do some things like sequence control decisions, loopings, control statements, all of these, but irrespective of the programming language. That is, since we have taught them pseudocode or some kind of an algorithm, we will do all these structures using one of those approaches rather than any syntactical representations of any language. After which we go on to some introductions to programming, classification and so on. Now this LD paper is an internal paper, and followed by that, I'm sorry, the things are chipping off, but the paper reads as Elements of Information Technology. This is another introductory paper in which we cover a little in depth about the memory and overview of the PC architecture, which is really basic because it is for UG students, and some software concepts, followed by the data representation, that is octal, hexadecimal and conversion from binary to octal and so on, followed by OS, some concepts about OS, and then introducing some of the Microsoft Office packages. Now after this, in the third semester, these students are exposed to the actual C programming, as we all have seen. And again, the syllabus for this C programming goes exactly as fundamentals, then looping, decision, arrays. Like it is more or less similar to what all has been covered till now, so I'm just running through it, and then we go till the IO. We end with the IO operations in C. Going beyond that, for the PG course, the LD and EIT, that is Elements of Information Technology papers, they are offered for all the UG courses, and for the PG courses, we have only one paper which is introductory, because most of the students who come for a master's in IT are their graduating background is in almost all the cases IT, and when we screen them, we also take care that we do not try and take in students who are from a different field, like, you know, biotechnology, or I mean we do take, but then we do not focus on entertaining students who are like BCom or BA or something like that, so that it is easier for those students to pick up the course. Also, we although we have some students like this, but then for them we follow a little different path. But in a normal course, for the PG courses, we only offer one paper called as Programming Concepts and Algorithms, which is again an introductory paper. I'm not getting into the details of that paper because it is more or less similar to what I've covered, the topics and so on. So I'm just showing you the syllabus of another Java subject, which is Java 1, and it's like core Java. Here we are touching upon the object orientation by taking the reference of procedural programming that they have learned. And then we move on to primitive types, keywords, starting with simple classes, what are objects, what are classes, how do you compile them. And then we move on to some concepts like packages, constructor, overloading. From then on to inheritance, polymorphism, anonymous classes, and this topic again, enums, assertions and annotations. We give this generally for a self-study topic. Again, this is not a rigid rule that we need to give this for self-study, but this is what most of the faculties who have taken up this course have decided, that this should be for self-study. But yes, we do have a freedom to change that. And moving on, we cover everything till swings. Swings, IO, threads, exceptions. One more point here is that we have not included JDBC as a part of this course, like in most of the colleges they do. Going forward, in all these four courses that we have seen right now, this is just a list of all the languages that we cover generally in semester 3, 4, 5 or maybe second year of some of the PG courses. After that, let's move on to the evaluation of these courses. We have a credit-based evaluation, like we have some allocated credits for each semester, each subject and each course within that. Now here, for the UG and PG, there is a difference in the way we evaluate them. Generally, for all the external papers, for the undergraduate level, we have a 40 and 60 marking. That is, the internal assessment for these courses is 40% of whatever are the total marks, and 60% is the external. And for PG courses, it's exactly the opposite. More weightage is given to the internal assessment and less to the external paper. Now, all the external assessment in case of PG and UG, it comprises of a semester end examination. That is, like, it happens at the university level. We get question papers from the university and so on. But for the internal evaluation, it is supposed to be a continuous evaluation. That is the 40 or 60, whatever it is, it has to be a continuous evaluation, and the criteria and the breakup of those criteria, that is the weightage of each criteria, is decided by the faculty who is going to handle that course. So if I am teaching suppose Java 1, then at the starting of the semester, I am supposed to give the breakup of that 60% internal weightage, and I would say that maybe 20% weightage would be given to the lab examination, 10% to the lab assignments, maybe 30% to the class test that I take. The only restriction in this that we have from the university is that you have to cover minimum 3 criteria in the internal evaluation. That is, you cannot say that for all the 60%, I will just take one examination throughout the semester. That cannot be done. You have to split it up across 3 different criteria minimum. And what are those criteria? That is something that the faculty is free to decide. The faculty who is taking up the course is supposed to provide the breakup and the weightage to the university at the starting of the semester itself. So we have a freedom on that terms, because you have some papers which are programming oriented, some which are theoretical. So in that they may want to take something like case studies and so on. So you can decide the criteria. And also these are only a few of them that I have listed. A faculty can go beyond that and say that I want to go with some other criteria also. So this is on the evaluation part. This is a sample lab assignment that we have written here. Question 2, I'm sorry for the misformatting that's taken place, but it was working fine on that machine. The question 2 here, it is a sample lab assignment that we give to students. It is asking them to calculate a simple square calculator, that is only squaring of the number. Now for the lab assignments that we take care, we do not get any kind of a structure or a prescribed format from the university. So it is we who have to devise everything right from scratch. And whatever assignments we have given last year, we can't give them this year, because our college, they have a very strong senior-junior network. So if seniors have done it already, the juniors will just do it in one day, because they have it already from their seniors. So generally we have to give a separate set of assignments every time. But we do not have any rigid rules on, you know, these are the 15 or these are the 20. We can devise it. So that's it. And generally we put these assignments on the shared drive, from which is accessible to all the students. They do it, and they have a separate drive for their PRN wherein they put those assignments, and after finishing they can upload that on the shared drive from wherein we can access them and see them. But only thing is that we do not have a long term storage mechanism for these assignments. That is, once they are done and evaluated by us, then they are deleted by the SISAD. So we do not continuously store them. And going ahead, this is the lab infrastructure that we have. We are having 5 labs. One of these is a network lab, because for MSc second year, we are having networking as a specialization. And there are about 200 plus terminals, all of which are connected to the LAN network. Our entire campus is Wi-Fi enabled, since most of the students have their own laptops. So they can be anywhere in the campus and be connected to the network as well as to the internet. And these are some of the peripherals and accessibility details that I've listed. So along with the Wi-Fi, we also have a lease line. So also internet is available morning 8 to 8, and the labs are also available 8 to 8 to all the students. All the 5 labs are open. There are some question papers. I was not able to get a soft copy of these question papers, so there is a hard copy here. This is just a sample paper of, purposely I'm not taking a C paper, because we all have seen a lot of C here. So I've taken a paper on web technologies. If you can see, it's for an MSc CA course. And here you have a question A, which is of 50 marks, and there is a sub option in it. There are 6 questions given, and the student need to solve 5 out of them. Again, this is these are a combination of theory as well as programming. And going beyond, on the other side, there is one 30 marks question, which is a complete application development. That is, they need to write an application in the paper itself, which is of 30 marks. So this is a pattern. Again, we do not have any kind of restrictions as to what should be percentage weightage to theory and to practical. So it completely depends on whoever is the paper setter. So there can be sometimes 20 marks of theory, there can be sometimes 50 marks of theory also. So there is no restriction as such. But we try to make it as programmatic as possible. But since we have to give some amount of theory, And also in the internal evaluation, we already try and cover most of the programming aspects by giving them some lab assignments and so on. And also about the evaluation, we do not have a fixed fixed grade for passing. That is, it's not 40% or 50%, but we do a relative evaluation, as in that in the class, we find out the class average of all the students, and 0.7% of that class average is the passing percent. So all those who are in the bottom 30% generally do not pass that course. They all have to reappear. So this is it, and if you have any questions, then it's open.
How many other colleges affiliated to university offer exactly the same programs? Meaning, are there multiple colleges who are going to teach exactly the same syllabus and courses at different places?
Sir, like I've showed in my first slide, there are three institutes under the Faculty of Computer Studies. So all of them, they offer these kind of programming courses, but they may not be exactly the same. Because SCIT, if you say, they are having separate specializations. They have specializations in security management.
No, when you said university, are you referring to Pune University or
no,
your own?
I am referring to Symbiosis University.
Oh, Symbiosis University.
Correct. And it has 19 constituent institutes.
Correct. Then why can't freedom be given to each constituent institute and teacher? Because they are a single university. They don't have to borrow rules from other universities.
So no.
This
so
external means what? Somebody else will set the paper.
Yeah, external as in that the paper for those courses, we will have teachers across the university who, in these three institutes, there are teachers who are taking care of IT related subjects. So centrally, there will be a repository collected of what all papers are required, and then they will be distributed to teachers of each college.
That's my biggest worry, that I can understand this is the normal practice in the university system.
Yeah.
But if I am an autonomous institution, where is the autonomy of a teacher? Why shouldn't teacher who has taught the course should set the paper?
So it is, because then, okay, there are two parts to this. One is that the teacher who teaches the course is more or less the internal paper setter for that. So, and there is an external paper setter who may be of ABC Institute or who may be a visiting to any of the constituent institutes. Second is that, the thing is that if you allow the internal, that is the faculty who's taught the paper to be the only paper setter, then they have a worry saying that, because they ask us many times that question also, that what is the guarantee that you are covering the entire syllabus? As in that, because there are 10 topics and I take only 6 topics and set the paper depending on those 6 topics, then there is an issue of maybe non-uniform.
My answer to the management is, you selected the wrong teacher for appointment. IIT system has been doing this, the top universities of the world have been doing this for, like, we have been doing it for 50 years, other universities have been doing it for 150 years, and there has been never any acquisition of this kind. Yes, so there have been exceptions.
There
have been exceptions even here. Everything is not hunky-dory. When you have so many people, there will be some problem. But the peer pressures are very heavy. Peer pressures are extremely heavy. I mean, I will not be so much worried about what will my students say. In fact, they will be very happy if I teach less and ask simple questions. Okay.
Yeah,
but my peers will not be. Let me also tell you some very significant thing. Teachers who have set simple papers and given huge ranks do not get top evaluations by students. Teachers who are some of the toughest teachers who have failed as many as 25-30% of their students get top evaluation by students. I think students understand, you know, what is good teaching and what is not good teaching. But this fear is, you see, this is the chicken and egg. So why I am saying this is, you are an autonomous institution. You are an autonomous university. At least this, if you change, because this does not give me a chance as a teacher to improve myself and come up to that expectation. I will always now feel that my job is this. I don't have to think. I don't have to apply my mind. Somebody else will examine. And my teaching will again be from that point of view. That half the questions are going to be asked by her, who doesn't know what I have taught. So therefore, I will be forced to cover every portion, because I don't know from which portion she will ask the question. I cannot therefore experiment with my teaching. I cannot introduce something else which occupies a larger portion.
So what you are saying definitely has a point, but then we have maybe not that 100% level of autonomy, but then we have some amount of say in terms of…
Oh, you are not 100% autonomous.
No, I mean in terms of the paper set.
Oh, individual colleges.
As in that, for the external paper setter, we always have a discussion. Like, if I get a list of papers that you are the internal paper setter for so and so papers, then I'm always given the contact number of the external paper setter, and we always discuss that, you know, this has been taught, this is the way I've covered this, or this is what I've focused on, and all that. So then we do get a chance.
It doesn't concern us, but it concerned me because I have been propagating autonomy for every college and for every teacher. Actually, the ultimate objective of teaching learning process should be autonomy of a learner. So some countries, like even Thailand, have this. I may do some 2 years of study in Chennai, and I may suddenly barge in Pune, and I want to do remaining credits from your place. Now that is perfectly permitted. All that this university or this new college should say is that, okay, you have done these courses, these are the credits. Out of these, I recognize these credits, other credits you have to do afresh. Now, this is the flexibility that a student gets there. Someday an Indian student should get that flexibility. Today, the only flexibility that poor student has is to purchase for 5,000 rupees a ready-made project. Now, but going to the teachers, I believe, please convey this to your university authorities, that Professor Phatak believes that the university is throwing away a golden opportunity. Because earlier when you were under Pune University or something, you seem to be moving towards that. You must move away from it. Yes. Anyway, sorry for digression because this is not concerned with our course. Okay, so
but I'm sure that if I say that this is your suggestion, people will definitely entertain it, because I'll just tell you one thing, that because when our head had called me to say that, you know, you go for this workshop or whatever, so I was a little hesitant, to be very frank. I said, what will I go and do out there? I mean, you know, I'm teaching Java and I'm happy teaching all these XML Java, and I want to be, you know, you send me for some learning J2ME, I will happily go. What will I go and do here? So then he held a paper and he said, you read this name, even if you go and hear this person talking for an hour, your entire purpose of going for the workshop is solved. So then, he's also an alumnus of IIT, but I'm not sure whether it's IIT Bombay. But then he told me that, so I was like, yes, and the name was of course yours. So then he said that, you know, you can take so much from him that even if you hear him once, I'm sure that your purpose will be solved. So you don't need to worry that why I should go. So I really got this opportunity.
Thank you very much. I am embarrassed by this observation. But I would like to clarify one thing. This workshop is not arranged for you to come here and learn at all. This workshop is not at all with that intention. This workshop is for all of us together to plan how we will help thousands of teachers to improve the effectiveness of their teaching learning. That is the purpose. Okay. Each one of us here, I'm sure each one of those 1,000 teachers and each one of those 6 lakh students who study programming are capable of handling themselves. Our job is that if certain effectiveness we see today, like 20% people failing, 25% people failing, or having these problems of the teaching and so on, how can we contribute collectively and set up a collective mechanism to sort of improve it over the years? That's the purpose. So the purpose I wanted you to be here is that it doesn't matter what subject you teach. Actually, you could very well be a mechanical engineer for all I care. But once you understand what is to be done for those 30, 40 teachers who will assemble at your place, the kind of environment that is to be given to them, that's good enough.
No, I'm sure this is a more enriching experience, because J2ME, I can go back and learn now.
Yes.